you mind taking us through the most simplistic form you can, what natural language processing is?
Sure. So I see natural language processing as using computational models and methods to deal with natural language. So for example, it might be about looking at what mathematical formalisms are useful for modeling language, or it might be about algorithms and techniques for doing something useful with natural language. So for example, all of these applications we have now in machine translation or search or personal assistant applications, they all count as part of natural language processing.
What's something it can do really well right now?
One thing that NLP does really well right now is that it can sift through large amounts of text and find useful and relevant information for you. And not just that, but it can start to do a little bit of analysis if it's for some purpose that the system knows about. So for example, a lot of mail systems right now, they can search through your email and extract all of the relevant information related to some trip you're making or a flight you're taking, and it can extract that and process it and put it in a form that's really convenient for you, so that when you get to the airport you can just click two buttons and you have your boarding pass.
Are there any common misconceptions?
One of the common misconceptions is that we're about to have some machine that can perfectly understand everything you could possibly throw at it in terms of language, and that you can interact with that system like you see in the movies, like on Her or like a HAL in Space Odyssey. So I think there's a lot of progress, and there's a lot of work to be done until we reach that level where it's really indistinguishable from people.
Why is understanding language such an important aspect when it comes to creating artificial general intelligence?
Language is just such a major part of how we communicate with each other. With language, we can express very complex and abstract ideas and thoughts. So language makes it much more convenient and makes the expression of these complex ideas much more compact. And language is also so flexible in that with enough effort, you can formulate almost anything into language form. Maybe not with perfect fidelity or perfect accuracy, but I think it's such a powerful mechanism for communication.
What are some recent breakthroughs in NLP that have gotten us closer to that place?
So in the past few years, I think one major breakthrough is the fact that now we're doing a lot better job of representing discrete symbols. If you think about it, at least in terms of text, text is a series or sequence of discrete symbols. So in the past few years, what has become very popular is to represent each of those words as some high-dimensional vector. And so this has several advantages. So one big advantage is that now we can make a lot more efficient use of our training data. So for example, you might have, say, the word cat and the word dog, and rather than viewing them as completely separate and independent discrete symbols, now they're represented as some high-dimensional vector. So that means if you have some example that you know will affect whether or not you think cat is representative of one class or not, that will also influence how you treat dog, even though the word dog was not in that original example. A second gain is the fact that with these vector space representations, and also now with deep learning techniques that use these vector representations and then feed them through multiple layers in some deep neural network, we can learn complex feature interactions. So what this means is that you might have some feature that is useful for your task, which is not just about the presence or absence of a particular word, but instead it involves some complex interactions in terms of some nonlinear combination of features in the input space.
What do you think are some of the major open problems in NLP that you're particularly passionate about?
So right now, I'm very interested in how we can analyze very long texts at the scale of, say, an entire novel. We really need to develop methods that can analyze the texts at a more abstract level. So, for example, you might want to be able to extract the plot of an entire movie or entire novel by reading the contents of the movie script or the novel text. And that's exciting because it means that we have to think about how we want to represent these high-level abstract ideas and how we can adapt our systems so that they actually work at that scale where you have tens of thousands of words. So we're not talking about hundreds or even thousands of words, but like really a lot more words than what we typically use in our current systems. So it turns out that in terms of how people describe the world and how language reflects that. It turns out what happens is that in most texts that we can find, there are large numbers of rare entities or rare events in there. And that's just the nature of how communication works. So we're much more likely to talk about something that's new and something that's unusual than something that we already know about. One consequence of that is that with our supervised learning techniques right now, it has to do a lot with a very small amount of data. So we're asking it to be able to understand, say, rare named entities, even though maybe in the entire training corpus they might have appeared less than 5 times, or maybe even not at all. So that's something that my group works on. So recently we had some work where we looked at something like language modeling. So there is some closed task where there is a blank that's missing in some context.
So what would that look like in action?
So we have some context, say word, a sequence of words and some blank that we're trying to reason about. And then the task is we have to figure out which named entity originally belonged there. And these are named entities that you might not have heard of before. They might be famous in some very specific subdomain, but maybe you haven't heard of them in general. And then what we'd like to figure out what entity goes into that blank. So this is similar to a standard language model. But what's different about our setup is that in our case, all of the candidates are going to be named entities. And these are named entities that you might not have seen during training, or you might only have seen 2 or 3 times. And so some of the standard techniques that we have, they might not work so well because they rely on having lots of examples of occurrences of these named entities. So which one is supposed to be what we fill in? So in our work, what we showed is that if you use some external definition, say for each named entity, if you have some definition, which I'll use D to denote, with a set of words associated with each of them, then that really makes the problem much more solvable. Because now we have some basic idea of, for example, which of these named entities are people, which are locations, which are, say, countries or some other type of named entity, and also maybe some basic information or defining characteristics about those named entities. So then we can reason both about the original context as well as the named entity in terms of its definitions and its maybe the few occurrences you have of it in the training example, and then we can pick hopefully the right one to fill in into the blank there.
You've said having the right definition for a problem is more important than solving an ill-defined problem itself. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so it's really important to have the right setup, because if you don't, you might end up optimizing something other than what you actually want. What we need is we need to have a battery of multiple tests, each of which tests a different aspect of the output that you care about. So this is in particular a pressing issue in language generation applications like summarization and translation. So you might need one measure like Rouge for the content. You might need another measure for the grammaticality. You need to sit down and figure out with domain experts what are the necessary qualities in the outputs of your system, and you need to develop measures that can actually account for each of them. The other aspect to this is that you might want to subject the output of your system to more rigorous testing. You might want to take your task and you can, say, figure out what are some plausible looking but incorrect answers, and you want to see whether your system is able to figure out which are the good examples and which are the bad examples. So recently in question answering, there's been work done, for example, where they could come up with these adversarial examples where you take an input passage and if you perturb it slightly, you add maybe one extra sentence of irrelevant information, many of the current methods will suddenly fail where they got the answer correct before. So I think we need to do the same kinds of things with many different language generation applications or other NLP systems to really test their robustness. We want to subject our NLP systems to more noise, more of the random things that can go wrong in the real world in terms of what data they'll see, and see how far we can push our system.